Hello, and welcome from me, Michael Scott, in Oxford in the UK. And thank you for joining me and Joseph Simmons, my co-convener for the series, who's also in Oxford. This is the 12th event in the second year of our Christian Literary Imagination series. It's a Georgetown University's Humanities Initiative in association with Campion Hall, Oxford, and the Las Casas Institute, Blackfriars Hall in Oxford. Today, I will be talking with Professor Elizabeth Schaefer, who will be discussing Elizabeth Tanfield Cary, who lived between 1585 and 1639, and Aemilia Lanyer, who lived probably 1569 to 1645. Liz Schaefer is one of the leading authorities of theatre and the history of theatre, theatre in performance, Shakespeare in performance. She joined Royal Holloway University, where she is now a professor, after having taught at La Trobe University in Melbourne and at the University of Wollongong in North South Wales. She is a prolific writer and editor on performance history and theatre personalities, including her biography of the great Lillian Baylis, one of the founders of the National Theatre in London and a stalwart during the Second World War of the Sadler's Wells Theatre and the Royal Ballet. Indeed, these theatres, I think certainly Sadler's Wells, would have disappeared altogether through the war in terms of any kind of performance, except for her. Liz has extensively worked on the Carolyn dramatist Richard Broom and has a specific interest in women as portrayed in drama, acting in drama, and creating drama, with publications, for example, on The Taming of the Shrew and Twelfth Night, as well as Elizabeth Cary's play, The Tragedy of Mariam. One of her great strengths is to perceive the different meanings and perceptions of the plays, for example, by Shakespeare, in different cultural contexts. She also has an interest in theatre and Christianity, which is the title of an excellent readable short study, which she published in 2019. She also has a chapter on Measure for Measure, hashtag Me Too and Performing Christianity Today, in Christian Shakespeare question mark, the book of our earlier series, you might remember, and that book is due to be published in the fall. After her talk, she will take questions submitted from members of our internationally based audience. We encourage you to participate by typing your questions directly to us from the moment we begin the session. You can do so by using your Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. If you have a question or questions, please ask them and we will endeavor to answer them either today or later by email. Please ensure that you use your Q&A button and not the chat button, Q&A. Well, with that, I turn over to Professor Schaefer. Elizabeth.
Okay, thank you, Michael, for that generous introduction. And thank you, yes, to everyone for joining us. I'm going to talk today about the work of two women who aren't always at the centre of the early modern canons for a whole variety of reasons. And I chose as my title, How Oft Have I With Public Voice Run On? Elizabeth Cary, Aemilia Lanyer, and the Publication of Women's Christian Literary Imagination in Early Modern England. And in that title, I'm using actually the first line from Elizabeth Cary's play, The Tragedy of Mariam. Mariam, the titular heroine, does run on with public voice, and she finds that comes at great cost, which I think is very fascinating given what her author was doing in terms of claiming the public voice. So what I'm interested in here is that both Aemilia Lanyer and Elizabeth Cary were remarkable in the early modern period for claiming and owning a public voice. And knowing the potential cost in terms of their reputation, and that this was something that women were not supposed to do in this period, to claim a public voice. Mariam, in The Tragedy of Mariam, is the wife of Herod the Great, And she finds that claiming a public voice, speaking out, leads to death. Actually, I'm just going to point out both of these early modern women lived an extraordinarily long period of time people tended to die a lot younger in those days. They both were long-lived, so nothing too dire happened as a result of them claiming a public voice. But what I'm really interested in terms of literary history today is that Lanyer and Cary are quite clearly groundbreaking and could be described as proto-feminist. So Lanyer is the first woman, as far as we know, to publish original poetry in English under her own name. I mean, her poetry is extant. We don't know if anybody else has published poetry that we haven't got any longer. But, Lanyer was really being pioneering in publishing her poetry and putting her name to it. Cary is the first woman to publish extant original drama under her own initials. I mean, everyone knew who E.C. was, but she didn't actually put Elizabeth Cary. The two women were in different situations in terms of class and power. Cary was upper middle class and had married into the aristocracy. Lanyer was much lower down the scale. But they both went out and claimed this public voice. And both women were also resoundingly Christian. And I'm really underscoring resoundingly. And it's this Christian element in their work, which proves much more of a challenge, I think, today when feminists go looking for heroines or heroes or sheroes. And when feminists go looking for inspiration from the way that these women broke the rules and struck out in new directions. Recent responses to both women's work in terms of their Christian imagination, and that's literary in the case of Lanyer and theatrical in the case of Cary, have chosen to renegotiate and I would even say circumvent or marginalise the Christian content of their work. So today what I'm first going to do is look at a play about Lanyer, which is a play called Aemilia by Morgan Lloyd Malcolm, which was on at Shakespeare's Globe in London. And secondly, I'm going to look at a very recent new production of The Tragedy of Mariam, directed by a new director, Jasmine Silk. Okay, I'm just going to try and share screen now. In 2018, Morgan Lloyd Malcolm's fiery, funny and feminist play, Aemilia, stormed onto the stage of Shakespeare's Globe. That is Shakespeare's Globe. It doesn't look how it normally looks, but it is Shakespeare's Globe. It has got a rather different kind of background compared to normal. And the play really surfed on the energy that had been generated by the hashtag MeToo movement in the wake of revelations about film producer Harvey Weinstein. The play focuses around the remarkable accomplishments of the historical woman Aemilia Lanyer. As Michael has said, 1560 to 1645 is kind of roughly, we're not quite sure about, no, we do know her dates, it's Cary we're not so sure of. But I'm just going to say she's Aemilia Lanyer, A.E. Aemilia. The play about her didn't actually choose to use the spelling that she herself preferred, that she used when she published her play, which I think is interesting. Anyway, Lloyd Malcolm's play urged audiences to listen to Lanyer's story, to sympathise with her struggles, and to applaud her determination to succeed. And audiences responded in an extraordinary fashion. When you look at the reviews, quite often the reviewers comment on how they're slightly perplexed by the enthusiasm of the audiences, who were predominantly young and female. This is not a traditional theatre audience, who cheered the Aemilias. They booed the mostly male villains. I mean, at the Globe, that there is always a slight element of pantomime. There was a lot of booing going on, and they delivered standing ovations. So an extraordinary response to this play, which then later transferred to the West End. So at the centre of the play is Emilia. That's the character's name. And she occasionally, but really rather rarely, speaks lines and phrases that Lanyer wrote and published. And, you know, there are short quotations from her poetry and also from a prefatory letter that she published with her poetry. And Lloyd Malcolm is very clear, I think this is very important, that the three actors who performed as Emilia at the three different stages of her life were not offering a historical representation. This is not a history lesson. So what she actually says is not a historical representation. It is a memory, a dream, a feeling of her. That's what Lloyd Malcolm says. Okay, so what I thought we'd start off with is some facts. So here are a few facts about Aemilia Lanyer and the kind of really critical thing in terms of her pioneering activity is that she publishes Salve Rex Judaeorum. For a woman of her class to have that kind of education and to be confident in Latin was relatively unusual. Lanyer came from two families of musicians, so we're very confident that she was very musical. But she probably had an extended education, humanist art education, courtesy of Susan Bertie, who was a member of the Protestant faction at the time. There she is, 76, that's a good age in the 17th century. Then what happens? So Lanyer gets ignored for a long time. And then towards the end of the 20th century, she's rediscovered, and she's unfortunately rediscovered by A.L. Rowse, who claims that Lanyer is the dark lady of Shakespeare's sonnets. And so what is happening here is that Rowse is positioning Lanyer as primarily of interest in relation to a man's love life, and in effect is drawing attention away from her literary accomplishments. Now, I'm just going to say that Shakespeare scholars and Lanyer scholars and the vast majority of literary historians agree that there is, in fact, no evidence to suggest that Lanyer was the inspiration for the Dark Lady of the Sonnets. There is a possibility that Lanyer and Shakespeare may have met. They both, at different times, but they both knew Henry Cary, the Lord Chamberlain, and they could have met via Henry Wriothesley, the Earl of Southampton, but they may not have met. But ever since Rowse bestowed the Dark Lady label on Lanyer, no amount of logic, research, scholarly argument, or any of the other usual stuff has been able to dislodge this argument. And I'm just going to draw your attention to the fact that Emilia opened playing alongside three Shakespeare plays that had female characters named Emilia. And this was programmed by Michelle Terry at the Globe. There's something very deliberate going on there. Okay, Rouse's main source of evidence on Lanyer's life was the popular astrologer Simon Forman, someone whom Lanyer consulted from 1597 onwards when she suffered several miscarriages, or as he put it in his diary, false conceptions. Forman made notes on his clients, but he also attempted to prey sexually on vulnerable women who were consulting him. And he does record that he attempted to initiate sexual relations with Lanyer, but she rebuffed him. So we have a problem here that if we're trying to access the real historical woman and writer, Aemilia Lanyer, if our only sources are the disappointed Simon Foreman and A.L. Rouse, who is running with this Dark Lady idea, both have got significant agendas in relation to her, then the resulting view of Lanyer will inevitably be desperately partial. But Lloyd Malcolm's vision of Lanyer in her play Aemilia is also, of course, partial and partisan. So if you're staging a play about Aemilia Lanyer at Shakespeare's Globe, I think you have to bring in the Shakespeare bit. There was no way she was not going to be the Dark Lady of the sonnets in a play staged in this space. That's Charity Wakefield playing Shakespeare in the play. He's a plagiarising wimp for most of the time. And basically what Lloyd Malcolm does is, I mean, it's an old joke, really. She makes the claim that many of Shakespeare's plays are grounded in Lanyer's words and actions, so that he has kind of plagiarised her life. Because Michelle Terry commissioned this play, the artistic director of the Globe, commissioned the play and programmed the whole season around Aemilia plays, this claim was particularly clear in relation to Othello. In the play Aemilia, there is actually the sequence, the willow scene where Aemilia and Desdemona are talking, and Aemilia is making, you know, kind of caustic remarks about men. And this is actually very much claimed by Aemilia in the play as stealing her words. The list of nouns that Lloyd Malcolm uses to explain her vision of Lanyer, however, does not include the word Christian. And I mean, normally this wouldn't be a problem, I suppose, but what she says specifically that she wants to happen as a result of her play being staged is that more people read Lanyer's poetry. And Lanyer's poetry is just saturated with Christianity. Lloyd Malcolm also makes Lanyer a person of colour, playing along with the Dark Lady. She makes her of North African or Central African descent, probably Jewish, and she completely downplays Lanyer's Christian commitment as merely strategic. So this is what Aemilia is, and she is not, I mean, you know, she sounds very modern, very enterprising, but she's not Christian. And the sequence in the play, which talks about publishing the poetry, positions the Christianity as strategic, a way to get a woman's voice published, to get a woman's voice past the censor. So I'm slightly puzzled about what's going to happen if someone enthused by the rabble-rousing of the play Aemilia rushes off to read Lanyer's major poem Salve Rex Judaeorum. This poem is quite long. It's ornate, it's deeply religious, and after 300 lines of praise for the Countess of Cumberland and a consideration of the importance of inner rather than outer beauty, this poem narrates the story of the Passion, beginning with Jesus praying in the Garden of Gethsemane and carrying on to the crucifixion and the resurrection. The poem includes Lanyer's defense of Eve, basically on the grounds that Adam knew what he was doing, Eve had not been informed of the full consequences. Lanyer also surveys a series of powerful women from the Old Testament, although primarily to compare them somewhat unfavourably with the Countess of Cumberland. Her other major poem, which is published in the same collection, is the description of Cookham, which is an area, a kind of Berkshire just up from Windsor. And this is the first extant country house poem, so it predates Ben Jonson's To Penshurst. And this again praises the Countess of Cumberland and her home in retreat from London. The Countess had separated from her very unsatisfactory husband and had kind of set up home with her daughter out at Cookham, and Lanyer spent some time there with them. also something that is slightly marginalised in the play is that Lanyer, in publishing her poetry, reached out to a network of women of great influence. She wrote a series of dedicatory poems addressed to wealthy, powerful, elite women at the very top of the social hierarchy. These include the Queen, Anna of Denmark, and her daughter, Princess Elizabeth, women who, unlike most of their contemporaries, were all very well educated and patrons of the arts. But this, the poems indicate that the target readership that Lanyer's thinking of, it's going to, it assumes profound knowledge of the Christian Bible, of women whose stories are recorded there, and also a commitment to the belief system that understands Jesus of Nazareth to be God incarnate, God reaching out to humankind. And just to put it bluntly, without knowledge of this system, a reader is going to need an awful lot of footnotes to get through Lanyer's poetry. I think also Lloyd Malcolm underplays the role faith played in Lanyer's poetry, not only in terms of subject matter, but also in galvanising Lanyer to, like the women that she references in her poetry, achieve extraordinary things given the prejudices of her contemporary culture. Okay, one recurring complaint by the mainstream reviewers of Aemilia was that the play did not showcase Lanyer's published words, but a selection of the poetry was published in the 2018 edition of the play Aemilia, along with the rather more user-friendly prefatory letter in which Aemilia Lanyer is speaking, I think, in a more accessible way to the 21st century. To the virtuous reader is a letter that spits fire at men who, and I'm quoting, forgetting they were born of women, do like vipers deface the wombs wherein they were bred. The letter denounces not only misogynist men, but it warns that women often internalize misogyny and speak against or to the detriment of the rest of their sex. It contests the misogynistic application of Christian scripture and stresses that Christ chose to be, quote, begotten of a woman, born of a woman, nourished of a woman, obedient to a woman. That Christ always took special care of and paid attention to women. Critically, I quote, after his resurrection appeared first to a woman. And then the next quotation, before he sent a woman to declare his most glorious resurrection to the rest of his disciples. Lanyer's implicitly arguing that women should be at the center of the Christian faith instead of demonized and on the margins of power. But I don't think there's any way of getting away from the fact that Lanyer's poetry can appear quite niche today. I'm now going to just briefly talk about Elizabeth Cary. So while Lloyd Malcolm was essentially marginalising Lanyer's Christian literary imagination, the recent production of Elizabeth Cary's play, The Tragedy of Mariam, even though it was actually performed in a church space, the old church, Stoke Newington, reinvented Cary as a punk. Now, part of me goes, look at that hairstyle. I think I would never argue with anyone with a hairstyle like that, but so maybe some of the punk came from that. And this recent production of Mariam was energetic, it was dynamic, it was exhilarating, and it brought the character of Cary on stage. So again, the playwright is on stage. This time she was dramaturging, she was writing, she was participating in her play. And the performance opened with a performer who was playing Elizabeth Cary and also some other characters writing, and a man came up to her, later we found out that this man was to become her husband, Sir Henry Cary. He took away the pen and walked off, but she had another pen hidden in her bodice, so she was able to carry on writing. And this actually reflects the story in the biography of Cary, that when she was young, Elizabeth Tanfield, as she was then, ran up rather large debts to the servants who smuggled candles to her room so that she could read after the early modern equivalent of lights out. Now, the biography of Cary is readily available, but it's interesting because it's told by one of her daughters. And the author, we're not sure which daughter, the author was one of the daughters who became a nun in the convent at Cambrai. And it's interesting because in the life, the author spends no time on Cary's groundbreaking action of writing plays. She probably wrote two, one play is probably lost, and probably staging Mariam and then extraordinarily publishing her play in 1613. What the author of the life is interested in, as you might expect for a nun, is Cary's major act of rebellion, which was her conversion to Catholicism whilst in Ireland. I'm just going to mention that her husband, Henry Cary, had been sent as a Protestant to, you know, quell the Catholic Irish, and Elizabeth Cary chose to convert to Catholicism whilst in Ireland. She subsequently kidnapped six of her children. She did have quite a lot of children. Six of her children so that they could be placed in convents and monasteries. So she got four daughters into convents, into the same convent, and two sons into a monastery. Cary consistently then refused to do what she was told to do, whether that was by her husband or Charles I. And often she sought the protection of the Catholic Queen Henrietta Maria, who is the dedicatee of the translation Cary made of Cardinal Perron's work. These are Elizabeth Cary's work. I'm just going to confess that I have not read Reply of the Most Illustrious Cardinal of Perron. I'm very genre-based. My interest is in the play, The Tragedy of Mariam, but the Reply of the Most Illustrious Cardinal of Perron shows someone who is very, very deeply interested in theological discussions. Okay, Cary probably wrote The Tragedy of Mariam around 1605. We don't know roughly, probably, but she published it in 1613, that learned, virtuous and truly noble lady, E.C. One of the interesting aspects of Mariam from the point of view of Christian literary or theatrical imagination is that some critics have detected Christ-like echoes in the character of the tragic heroine Mariam, particularly through her refusal to engage with Herod during her sham trial. I mean, it's Herod the Great, not the other Herod. But, and also she makes a comment, as reported by the messenger or nuncio, that, quote, by 3 days hence, if wishes could revive, I know himself would make me oft alive. And the 3 days is seen to be part of these kind of faint echoes of Christ. Mariam is a passive victim to Herod's state violence, and the man who framed her, the butler, hangs himself, which again might evoke the story of Christ. Fascinatingly for me, the poster for the production, if it is read through a Christian critical lens, might also raise a few questions. I get that it's I am Mariam, but I am is also quite a loaded phrase, particularly for a play that is being performed in a church and which is full of references to Jewish history. I also think, though, that the poster is trying to place Mariam in relation to Hamlet, and that there's I mean, I would argue there's quite a lot of conscious evocation of Hamlet in Mariam. I think Cary's picking up on Mariam on Hamlet in several ways. Now, these kind of Christian considerations, I suppose, the faint echoes of Christ that might be swirling around the character of Mariam, that they're not for me the centre of the play, but in this production by Cutpurse Theatre Company, and they're named for Moll Cutpurse, a transgressive early modern woman who dressed as a man. This theatre production turned the play around completely, and it made the tragedy of Mariam, the faintly Christ-like character, into the comedy of Salome. Salome is Herod's sister, and she is a Richard III in a frock. She's villainous through and through, and theatrically she is irresistible. She's an absolute arch villain. What's more, the soundtrack in the production to Salome's rule breaking, she announces that she's decided she's going to get divorced. She's not allowed to, so she's going to become the first woman ever to get her own divorce. Live punk music belted out between the scenes, and also played when people were celebrating to signify the liberation they felt when it was wrongly believed that Herod is dead. You know, later on they find out he's not, and that's why it's a tragedy. What was interesting to me, though, is that even though this production brought Elizabeth Cary on stage, she was a character, she participated, she played roles, and at the beginning she moulded characters slightly like a puppeteer. But what the production was really suggesting was that she got seduced by her own creation, by Salome, into wanting to break the rules. So the same performer who played Henry Cary at the beginning, taking the pen away from Elizabeth, also played Salome's doomed and wanted husband, Constabarus. Salome ends up arranging him to be judicially executed. So this one actor was representing much that is dreadful in patriarchy. And Constabarus is not, it's quite understandable, he's pretty fed up with, Salome and women in general. On the way to his execution, he delivers a misogynist rant. But shortly after that, Constabarus morphed back into a Henry Cary figure and came over to Elizabeth Cary to take her in marriage, to take her up to the altar rail in the church. The punk band were just behind the altar rail. She resisted, but then gave in and knelt at the altar rail, which was decorated with pages ripped from books and kind of suggested that she was not going to be turned away from writing and publication. But as Cary then led his wife away, she cast a longing look back at the villain Salome. And Salome was dancing in joy, and it wasn't quite pogoing. I mean, I'm old enough to remember pogoing, but it was dancing in joy. It was bouncing up and down. She had won hands down. She was dancing in jubilation. It was almost Bacchic. And I think even for people who did not know the history of Elizabeth Cary's marriage, it was pretty clear where the Cary marriage would be heading. Salome is the most interesting character in Cary's play by far, and her transgressive speeches they really speak to Cary's achievement, Cary's breaking of the rules. Salome was a modern woman ahead of her time, and she was tempting Elizabeth Cary to think outside, as it were, the box. But of course, the rebellion she tempted Elizabeth Cary with was, well, I've become a punk. No, not exactly, but break the rules, publish a play, claim a public voice. It certainly wasn't the rebellion of converting to Catholicism. It was being shameless in breaking the rules that women are supposed to obey. So I'm really interested in the fact that both Lanyer and Cary have made recent appearances on the London stage in rather different contexts. Shakespeare's Globe, lots of reviews, all the mainstream reviewers there. London Fringe, no reviews at all. Their Christian imaginations have fared rather differently. Lanyer's has been reconfigured as primarily strategic. It's a device to get past the censor. And I would suggest, Lloyd Malcolm just thinks Christianity, Lanyer's Christianity, is uncool. But what does that mean if people then go and read her poetry, Lanyer's poetry? They're going to slightly come up against a Christian brick wall, if that's an appropriate phrase. But I think that I am actually more interested in the fact that this young, exciting theatre company have decided to present Elizabeth Cary as being seduced by her own villain, Salome, the proto-feminist schemer, and all she stands for. Okay, thank you. I'm just going to leave you with an image of Salome from a previous staging, because I just love this so much. This is actually in Burford Church. Burford Church is the church where the image that was used in the publicity came from. There's an effigy of Elizabeth Cary Tunfield Cary in the church. And this is just an image of Salome about to take control of Mariam's life. Thank you.
Well, thanks, Elizabeth. That was terrific. I've had a few questions come in. Catherine Temple is asking, hang on, I've just got to get it. It's just disappeared on me. Yeah. She says, thank you for presenting this fascinating material. I loved your juxtaposition of memory, dreams, and feelings with facts. Do you think there's some value for women in the memory, dreams, and feelings side of the equation? It seems to me that there's more value in the juxtaposition than in either dreams or facts alone.
Yeah, I think so, because I mean the facts are often rather depressing and not very motivating. And I think it ties in with discussions about realism, for example. And if you write realistic plays, then you don't imagine other possible futures, other possible existences. This is true of novels as well, of course. I mean, if you write in, for example, science fiction, you can write dreams, you can create things that didn't happen, and that may actually be a lot more exciting and challenging and provocative than documentation of the facts, because sometimes, certainly in relation to the early modern period, you kind of just going through an awful lot of appalling stuff. And Emilia evokes the witch hunts, so you know parts of that play get pretty bleak. But I think yes, the dreams and the hopes, I think it's great to have a mix. It's quite hard being in the audience at a play like Emilia without just kind of checking the things that are actually not facts for me anyway. But I hope others were not going on that particular journey. I was just sitting there going, witches weren't burned in England, which was, it worked thematically in the play because it's all about fire and passion and burn the house down if it doesn't work for you. But I was going, oh, they were hanged in England, with Scotland and burnt witches. So that's probably a bit of my own lack of imagination. But I think, yes, that mix is that kind of cocktail is very exciting.
Thanks, Angela Preston. Hello, Angela. Nice to hear from you again. Lanyer was both a pioneering woman, Angela says, and at the mercy of men. She became pregnant as a lord's mistress and was married off. Her insistence on God's love of women is remarkable. Do you think a church today would read and embrace her work? How far have we come in the acceptance of this truth?
Well, I think that is very interesting, and it's quite hard to excavate what was happening between Lanyer and Lord Cary. He was a lot older than her, and he was, you know, the Queen's cousin. He was immensely powerful, and she had a son by him, but she did seem to live a very affluent lifestyle, have a privileged lifestyle while she was associated with Cary, and she was his mistress. So yeah, I mean, she was operating outside marriage. That was a situation that came to an end probably when she gave birth to Cary's son, but definitely when Cary died not long afterwards. And she does seem to have kind of regretted the fact that she then lost access to the court. So she, even Simon Foreman admits that Elizabeth I, was very appreciative of Lanyer. So she met the Queen, she moved in court circles. And so then she is no longer in court circles once Cary's died. I'll get to church in a minute, but I do just want to say, what I find really interesting that though, so she's there as the mistress of Henry Cary. And then what she does is she moves in to live with the Countess of Cumberland and her daughter, the amazingly wonderful Lady Anne Clifford, who also spent, you know, most of her life arguing with men and defying the king. And they seem to have kind of worked together and created this little Eden, temporary Eden at Cookham. But the whole point about the Countess of Cumberland, the reason that she separated from her husband, is because he had so many mistresses, and yet she'd welcomed into her household a woman who had been operating as a mistress of a powerful lord. So, I mean, I don't have an answer on the churches. In my experience, it depends which church you're in. It's not even, you know, like Church of England or Catholic. It depends whether you're in Egham or in Thorpe or up the road in Virginia Water. The churches vary so much. But I think that there's a very, very interesting journey that Lanyer is on, which in her poetry, she's justifying women in all kinds of different situations, including, you know, there's an extensive section justifying Eve in a period where it was, you know, just some groups of people just blamed women, as represented by Eve, for all the ills in the world. And there's that terrible early modern woman woe man, the woe of man sort of conception. So I think that what's happening there is that there's a sense of defensiveness, but there is also a sense of moving on, and there's a sense that she wants to be saying that that Jesus is reaching out to everyone, and that people really ought to be paying attention to how much he reaches out to women, how much he speaks to women, and so women really have more spiritual authority than they're given credit for in most of the time in 1611. I hope that goes towards answering your question.
Thanks for that. Did Elizabeth Cary and Aemilia Lanyer know each other?
Well, it's impossible to say. I mean, it's perfectly possible that they did know each other, but there's no evidence. What I think is very interesting, though, is that Lanyer publishes her poems in 1611, and then 2 years later, Cary's publishing The Tragedy of Mariam, a play which we know she wrote a lot earlier. I should say with Cary, what happened was that she married her husband, and they didn't have children. He was off doing things, I don't know, fighting or in Europe. Once they started having children, she was having like one after the other. The biography indicates that she, suffered from postpartum depression and all sorts of things. There's kind of very, very interesting information there about what she went through once she started, as it were, mass production on the family front. And there is very much the sense that she didn't have time to write. But just at the beginning of this period, she publishes this play. And I think that there are several reasons why this play was published in 1613. But I do think that it might well have been a response to Lanyer's publication of her poetry and putting her name to it. I think there's that. It's a small world, isn't it? Jacobean London. So I think it's likely that they knew each other, but there's no definite connection.
Do you think Elizabeth knew about the professional theatre, the Lord Chamberlain's men, King's men, and so on?
One of the things that the biography says is that she loved going to plays. This is probably at court rather than hanging out at the Globe. But she loved plays, and when she was going through a particular period of needing to kind of mortify herself, she gave up going to plays, which she saw as a huge sacrifice. We know that she knew about theatre, And I think particularly the way that Mariam picks up on Hamlet is really, really interesting. And so, we know that she encountered professional performance. And of course, as an aspiring aristocratic woman, she'd be trained in all kinds of performing arts. I mean, the expectation is that you can sing and dance and be ready to perform in a mask at court if necessary. So, you know, this performance practice is part of the training of a young aristocratic woman. So I think she would probably have seen stuff at court.
So that leads me to another question, which is, because at court, women could play in masks and could, as you say, perform in performing arts, but in public that wasn't allowed. I just wondered, in an earlier article you write of the Tragedy of Mariam, the play is full of complex, feisty, stroppy female characters plotting and scheming. It doesn't really deserve to be labelled a closet play. What does make it in your mind a Jacobean? What does make it in your mind, I say, is a Jacobean performance play? And who would have performed it? Yeah. You know, it's not a closet play.
No.
Well, you argue very well. Sorry, you argue very well in that early article you did. I don't know, it was in the Sunday Times or something, but you argue very well that this would have been performed. Mm. So who would have performed it? Mm. And do you think they're feisty women who've performed it? That's what I was trying to get at.
I do. Michael, wave at me if I get on my soapbox and go on for too long. But the notion that this is a closet play is invented. It doesn't say on the title page, never to be performed, only to be read in silence. The notion of closet drama is something that really comes in a lot later, I think. I don't know if it was performed. There's no documentation, but it seems to me quite odd to write a play if you've got absolutely no intention of performing it. You could have written a long poem. You could have written an epic. You could have written other things. But especially for somebody who loved going to see plays. But I think the point about Mariam is that the play text includes several features that are nonsense if it is meant to be read simply. You don't get it in a way that you do in performance. So, for example, I mean, basically the reason that Mariam ends up dead at the end is because she refuses to come out of mourning once Herod returns. So the fact she is dressed in black, this is one of the Hamlet overtones, is really important. Now, very few readers will be able to kind of keep that in their minds while they're reading, but on stage this is really effective. And in her interactions with Herod, it says he comes on stage and he's got two guards with him. The guards say nothing, they do nothing. That's but it. They are really important. This is a public scene. This is not, you know, a husband and wife arguing in private. This is the king and queen, and people are present. There's a fight. What does that mean in a reading? There are lots and lots of features. And the feature for me that is really interesting is the notion of the long entry, which we did actually experiment. Myself and a colleague, Rebecca McCutcheon, we experimented at the Globe with this. And Mariam has quite a few long entries where it's something that works very well on the Globe, which is where a character comes on and a character is on stage, has a few lines to allow them to get across.
Yes.
It's quite big. So there are lots and lots of features that I think suggest performance. And we know that in the houses of the aristocrats of the period, entertainments were put on. And I don't see why Elizabeth Cary couldn't have performed this in maybe Beaufort Priory, which is where she was brought up and where her parents lived. I think it's more likely to have been at one of the houses associated with her husband's family. But I also think it's important to note that her uncle, who she dedicated her text on geography to, Sir Henry Lee, what he was, well, actually, he was well known for having a mistress, but he staged tilts to entertain Queen Elizabeth. So she got someone in the family who was used to disrupting his home and stage managing huge, you know, entertainment events. So I just don't think that there's any mileage in talking about this as a closet drama, because what's happened over the years is that people have gone, oh, it's a closet drama, so it's unstageable, which is not the same as not intending to stage it. And it's, the play has been staged now many, many times, but it's a kind of way of shutting down the public voice of Elizabeth Cary, saying, oh, she didn't mean it to be spoken. Now, if it was performed in one of the homes, stately homes associated with her family, then I think it's highly likely that Cary performed in it herself. And I just want to say, this play, it, you know, there's act one, scene one, act one, scene two, act one, scene three, act one, scene four. And then the first man comes on stage. There's no other play like this in the early modern period. Four scenes full of women. You've got to wait till the 1970s before you got anything like that in English theatre, in my view. I don't know, there might be a Susanna Centley, but correct me if I'm wrong. But, you know, this is a play full of women speaking out in all kinds of ways. And I think she probably performed one of the roles, in which case I'm kind of, you know, it's speculation. But it'd be great if she played Salome, which is a response to the latest production. I don't think I ever thought that she might have played Salome before. But I don't actually, you know, all right, the example I always use is Wojtek. Who sits around and goes, oh, Wojtek was written for a theatre that didn't exist, and so therefore it was a closet drama, and so we won't take any notice of it. But that's the kind of argument that is used against Mariam. Oh, she didn't put it on the stage. She couldn't put it on the stage, so therefore it's limited.
It can't be any good.
Yeah, and that's a problem for me. So I'm...
It becomes a problem with this whole kind of thing of the attribution of texts anyway by academia, which is interesting because they acquire the text, academia, use them as literary artifacts, and then don't use the texts, which they don't want to use, which they call closet texts. Do you see what I mean? It's an establishment culture that went through for hundreds of years.
Yeah, and it effectively marginalized it. I mean,
correct.
Even the term, it's got all kinds of overtones, but it certainly doesn't.
Yes.
It should be staged. As I say, nobody calls Wojtek a closet drama. Do they? I've never seen it anyway. Yeah. No. Earth-shatteringly original, yes, but closet drama, no.
Yeah. Yeah. And there's all that stuff with A.L. Rouse and the dark sonnets and Riversley and so on. I think Rouse has got all kinds of things wrong there, because I don't think Mr. W.H. has anything to do with Riversley, you know? Don't think so. Yeah. In any case, yeah.
Well, I think he managed to tell a good story, but his history is questionable. But people like the story, I suppose.
Yeah, I suppose so. Yeah. Oh, it's a good story. It must be true. Yeah. Perhaps Mr. Putin has read him. Anyway, let's not get into politics. Do you think that? You know, in Lanyer's poems, what difference was there when the world began? Was it not virtue that distinguished all? all sprang from one woman and from and one man. Then how does gentry come to rise and fall? Do you think Lanyer's got a subtext going on, hovering around here, which is the same as Cary's when Cary asks, why should privilege to man be given? You know, yeah. Do you think there is within intellectual debate amongst women this kind of understanding of how they're being put down in life all the time?
I think it's highly likely that that there's a web, a network, a group of women who are aware of each other, even if they're not, you know, closely connected. I mean, the other woman I think is really important here is Mary Sidney, and who's translating the Psalms, of course, and completing the Philip Sidney started the sequence, and she completed them. There's a group of women who are pushing at the boundaries and who are articulating their discomfort with the assumptions about how they should behave. But the section that you're quoting from Lanyer, I think, is really interesting, because it's actually addressed to Anne Clifford, who by this stage is Countess of Dorset, who's an aristocratic woman and Lanyer is not. And this particular verse, I think, it's questioning about how women are constrained by society's expectations. But it's also looking at class issues, how does gentry come to rise and fall? And that is pretty loaded, I think, given that Lanyer had benefited from the hospitality of the Countess of Cumberland. And that's how her friendship with Anne Clifford had begun. So I think that's quite an interesting one. And I mean, Elizabeth Cary, you know, she wasn't as secure as an aristocrat as her husband was. She was upper middle class, really. And I think there's some very interesting kind of, working through that in Mariam, in the racism. Mariam is she's appalling in some things she says to Salome. I mean, basically, Mariam is saying, you know, my Jewish blood is better than your Jewish blood. In fact, she calls Salome a mongrel at one point. And I think that's a kind of interesting version of this sort of nervousness about, the security of your position within society.
Angela Preston comes back with a question. Do you think women still have a difficult time having a public voice on religious matters? How so?
I think they do, but again, I think it depends on the context and the locality. In Egham, the local vicar is a Zimbabwean woman, and she speaks out, but she gets a lot of flack for it, not from the church, but, you know, the same church, the Church of England, All Souls in Langham Place, women are still not allowed to preach. So that it's mystifying to me that within one church you can have one set of rules and sort of 5 miles down the road there's another set of rules. But I think, yes, women do still have problems speaking out in relation to some topics and in some contexts. But I mean, I think it's a lot better than it was in Lanyer's time.
I think you've demonstrated actually the Christian imagination at work within these feisty women, you know, and done so very well. Catherine said she's had to sign off to go to another meeting. She wants you to know how much she enjoyed the paper, as did I, as did I think the other people here who've been listening to you. It's been a wonderful paper, and I'm very grateful to you. Our next event in this series will be on Tuesday the 17th of May, when Colleen Parsons from Georgetown is going to be talking about Olive Schreiner's book, Story of an African Farm and the Question of Progress. So again, a very interesting book that some people won't know of, but well worth coming to listen to Colleen on 17th of May. Another event that you might like to note is that Free Speech Project at the Crossroads International Dialogues event, in association with the Humanities, Future of the Humanities Project, will be on Monday the 16th of May, when we'll be discussing the impact of the war in Ukraine. And we have some very, very highly respected speakers, including a former ambassador to Ukraine and one of the leading authorities on law, on the laws pertaining to war. And indeed, even the great, the granddaughter of President Eisenhower is Susan Eisenhower, who in herself is a leading authority, will be talking then. We'd like to thank those at Georgetown who made this happy, this happy event happen. Julia Murillo and Mary Gordon, who worked to make the Zooms possible. Our thanks as ever to Dr. Jack DeJoya, the president, and Dr. Tom Banchoff, vice president of Global Affairs. Campion Hall, Nick Austin, SJ, Joseph Simmons, my co-convener, Sarah Gray, and Ying Ying. There's Joe. Thank you, Joe. At Blackfriars, to Richard Finn, director of the Lascasas Institute, John O'Connor, Kinga Rona Gabnai, and as ever, my thanks to Maggie Scott for helping on the administration. Finally, thank you all for being part of the audience. Please join us again for some of these events, and in the meantime, take care, keep safe, enjoy your reading. I'm Mike Scott. Please follow me on Twitter @MikeScottProf. Thank you and goodbye.